Today on Earth Focus, new ways to grow food in cities, from truck farms to vertical skyscrapers. And as the climate changes, cutting-edge science finds ways for plants to adapt to drought. Coming up on Earth Focus. Growing food on trucks? Entrepreneur and filmmaker Ian Cheney may be onto something. His film, Truck Farm, looks at innovative ways to grow food in cities.
You borrow a technology that others have invented for growing plants upon a roof. Truck farm, it's like a roof. Truck farm, it's like a roof. But this is no ordinary roof. First goes a barrier called a root. Barrier that keeps the roots out of your brain. Second goes a mat called a drainage mat that helps the water to drain. Then you have a blanket, an erosion blanket that keeps the soil from washing away. And then you have some special lightweight soil that gives the roots a place to play. Truck farm, it's like a roof. Truck farm, it's like a roof. But you can't drive around in a roof.
The inspiration for the truck farm project was really born of necessity. I moved to New York City, wanted to have a place to grow some of my own food, but didn't have any place to do it. And I took a good long look at the back of my old Dodge pickup truck and realized that it was about the same size as a backyard garden bed. So borrowing some technology from rooftop gardens, I made a truck farm happen.
That's pretty good.
Most of us grow up in cities. The majority of the world's population is now an urban population. And in the United States, we've long been, for several generations, a predominantly urban people. And what that means is we grow up without an understanding of certain fundamental things that our grandparents or great-grandparents would have taken for granted. You know, where food comes from, where water comes from. So truck farms are doing one tiny little part of that. Even by driving through a neighborhood or even by being parked on the side of the street, there's this visual reminder that food comes from somewhere. It grows. It comes up out of the dirt. It needs resources to survive. It needs healthy soil. It needs rainwater. It needs access to sunlight. Somebody grows it. It has a story. It has a backstory. And I think the more reminders we have that the stuff we consume every day, which we take for granted, actually has a backstory, I think the more careful we'll be about what we choose to buy. And I think those decisions will then ripple back through the economy to make every aspect of our supply chains and our food system more sustainable. I think truck farms teach us that to make the food movement itself sustainable, maybe we do need to inject some amount of fun and whimsy and out-of-the-box thinking into the way we are designing our food system. I've seen truck farms get a much broader circle of young people interested in growing food than we might have otherwise. So I think there's a lot of room for creativity and innovation in the food system. Not long ago, we launched a truck farm fleet where we encouraged groups and individuals around the country and cities and counties all across the country to start their own truck farms, their own mobile gardens to educate young people about how fun and easy it is to grow their own food. They've been popping up everywhere. Our first summer of the truck farm fleet, at peak summer, we had 25 truck farms in cities all across the country, and they're continuing to pop up. I believe the latest one that emerged was actually overseas. It was Truck Farm Palestine. So who knows, maybe it'll take fire internationally as well.
Today we're making our first delivery of truck farm produce to nutritionist Marion Nessel, who has paid $20 for a subscription to the summer truck farm.
So it's very casual, and I don't fuss much with it, and I kind of let things do what they do. But it has some interesting food. It has, for example, it has blueberries. There's your truck farm, 12 flights down. I once talked to a produce manager for one of the big food chains in California about how long it took to get California produce from a vegetable farm in Salinas to, you know, one of the grocery stores in this neighborhood. And he explained the whole thing. It was about 2 weeks. So if you pick this and put it in your refrigerator and keep it in your refrigerator in a week, you can still eat it. It'll be fine. You can't keep produce from California in your refrigerator for a week. It'll be mushy because it's much, much older and the nutritional quality will have deteriorated. The taste is gone. Broccoli from California doesn't taste anything like that adorable creature is going to taste. Oh, thank you. This is wonderful. It looks delicious. You don't think I can... it's good.
The truck farm is not the solution to our urban food problems or our global food problems, of course. It's a garden in a pickup truck. It was never meant to be a suggestion that everybody should abandon their farms and plant food in pickup trucks, or that if everybody in a city had a pickup truck filled with food, that everything would be okay. But I do think truck farms teach us a few things. Food is, of course, very fundamental. You know, we all have to eat. But it's also a window onto larger issues. It's a window onto environmental issues, on social issues, onto political issues. So by understanding how we eat and how we grow our food, we can understand a lot about what makes our world tick. And through that, understand better how to promote a more sustainable future. The way we eat has a tremendous impact on the natural world and therefore on the ability of future generations to survive. So if we can figure out a way to eat, we can not only make our own lives better and healthier, but we can also figure out how to make the planet more sustainable in the long run.
If there are 8 million people in New York City eating 2,000 calories a day, there are 365 days in the year, that's a lot of food, you might say. How much food do we really need, and how much food can we grow? Let's get down to the facts, my friends, this is something we'd all like to know. There are 32 teeth in the human mouth, and 28 feet of intestines. And water in Niagara Falls flows 150,000 gallons per second. The largest dinosaur weighed 200 tons, but only 75 on Mars. Not every man grows a mustache, but people like the smell of new cars. Let's get down to the facts, my friends, this is something we'd all like to know. The answer is we need a lot of food, we should grow it every place it can grow.
The Window Farm Project is all about making it possible for New Yorkers and any urban dwellers to grow food in their apartment year-round. I remember looking at the interior courtyard of my building, the six-story multifamily building that had, you know, it's just the central area where you leave all of your garbage. And the whole area is just covered with windows going all the way up. I remember taking a picture of it and thinking, what if we were all just growing food inside of this kind of unused space? After that, it was just like a series of experiments. It is making it possible for at least people to learn much more about how plants work and how to grow their own food and kind of just building up our own confidence, basically, about our ability to survive on our own.
Thank you.
While making the truck farm film, I think it was very surprising and instructive to think critically about urban agriculture, to question whether truck farming or rooftop gardening or vacant lot farming or window farming, growing food on boats floating in the harbor, whether this is a good idea or not. And of course, few of these urban farmers were suggesting that these are the solution to our global food problems. But it was still helpful to say, why are we doing this? Because it sheds a lot of light on what we do need in cities. I think a lot of people are growing food in cities because they miss working with their hands. And they also miss the taste of freshly grown food. And then on a larger scale, I think a lot of people are growing food in cities because we like the idea of being able to live in a vibrant social environment, but not be totally divorced from the natural world. And I think these urban farmers are all part of this project to figure out what cities of the future could and should look like.
Lunch pails and tennis balls and printers and boots, a family of unusual farms. Truck farm has a family now. My loneliness is gone and the vegetables are here, and soon we'll be planting again.
Truck and window farms provide healthy local produce, but the needs of growing urban areas will also require large-scale sustainable solutions. In Sweden, Hans Hassel, the CEO of Plantagon, is planting a new seed for the future of urban agriculture. Plantagon, a leader in vertical urban agriculture, will construct a cutting-edge greenhouse in the Swedish city of Linköping. The aim is to produce more food using less space, to deliver fresh produce at lower cost by marketing directly to consumers, and to embody a new business model, one that makes money while doing good.
Hans Hassel, Plantagon International. It's a new concept. What is it?
We are trying to be part of finding technical solutions on how we're going to feed the future really huge mega cities of the world. We are sure that we will have many reasons for growing food large scale inside our cities, and we want to be part of developing those new solutions for how to do that. We do believe that we will have three different problems to feed people living inside the city. One is the vast geographical sprawl of the cities. 2040, 2050, most scientists agree that 80% of 9 billion people will live inside cities. And already today, we are using 80% of the arable land that we have on the whole planet. If you put these two developing curves together, then you easily realize that what will happen is that we have to grow food, large scale, inside the city. City is a dense environment. The land is really, really expensive. So if you want to grow things in the city, you have to go vertical. And to go vertical, then you have to develop new technical solutions, and that's what we're doing.
Urban agriculture, vertical farming, what does it look like? How does it work?
Vertical farming is about getting a good ratio between the footprint on the ground and how much growable area you can get out of a building. So growing things vertical makes only sense if you don't have enough land where you want to grow your food. The way that we solve it is from constructing a building where you don't work with horizontal stories. Instead, we have an open construction using a helical shape that lets much more sunlight into the core of the building. And then we have a patented logistics system for how to move our crops at the same time as they grow inside this vertical building.
When will the Plantagon greenhouse begin producing, and what will it produce?
Objective is to have the building in Linköping ready at the end of 2013. depends on the local authorities. We're ready to start building at this stage, so we're just waiting for the approval. We will have a production of 300 to 500 tons every year, and on that building, the footprint on the ground is 400 square meters. And that's the whole point of doing things vertical. On the footprint on the ground of 400 square meters, that's like a normal garden that you would have to your house. We produce 500 tons of food every year. In Linköping, we will be growing pak choi, mitsuna, and chrysanthemum. In a dirty city environment, you need to grow things in a closed system, or at least semi-closed system. That means that you can't, you have to have as little people going into the system as you possibly could to protect it from being, having to use pesticides and other things. What we, or and everyone else, is developing is therefore a system that is like a, everything goes around. You plant at the same place as you harvest. That means that the whole farming machine that we are building is much more efficient than if you would do this on freeland, because then you would move things around all the time. Here, in a sense, you're actually moving the field that you're growing on. Instead of moving people and machines around, you move the things that are growing. And that means that it gets much less labor intensive. This is both good and bad, of course, because you take work opportunities away in one sense. On the other hand, if you don't compete with the freeland growers, you don't disturb their market and their jobs. And you create new jobs inside the city, also opening up for a sort of new people becoming farmers. If you would ask my children if it would be cool to become a farmer, I think they would say no. If you would ask them if they would be interested to work in this kind of high-tech, futuristic building that are producing food inside the city, they might very well say yes. And in India, for example, one of our main markets, this is the main reason for them to work with urban agriculture, to get the young people interested in becoming farmers. When you have a normal greenhouse business, it's much less expensive to build a normal greenhouse than to build one of ours. On the other hand, to run a normal greenhouse is much more expensive than to run one of ours. The life cycle of one of ours, we are building real estate where you can grow food at the same time. A greenhouse, you build them, you take them away after 20, at the most 30 years, and then you build a new one. So we are just rationalizing an old industry and making it like a second generation greenhousing. And when you do things like this, when you automize and industrialize an old system, you always have higher investment costs and lower costs at the end. So the payback time in Linköping, for example, it's about 5 years on the whole building. So the business case for this is really, really good. You also have to remember that the cost of a tomato, if you buy a tomato at a grocery store, about 60% is middleman cost, transportation and the store selling the tomato. We're taking all that away. We're selling directly to the consumer. So even if we have to invest higher, we have much less costs at the end for our sales.
Meeting tomorrow's food needs goes beyond cities. As the climate changes, there are more droughts. Rainfall patterns are less predictable. Providing food to growing numbers of people becomes increasingly challenging. But scientists at Penn State University, working with the National Science Foundation, may have the answer. They are finding ways to adapt plants to stressful conditions like lack of water.
Jonathan Lynch, we're in your greenhouse. It's part of your research laboratory system. What's going on here?
Well, what we're doing here is growing plants under stress conditions, meaning conditions that plants don't like. In the third world, in developing countries, people cannot afford to irrigate and fertilize their crops. And that's one reason there's 1 billion hungry people on the planet. Now, 1 billion hungry people is more hungry people than we've ever had in the history of our species. So you've got a challenge our species is going to have to confront that's really unprecedented. which is, you know, how do you sustainably feed a population of 9 or 10 billion? Most of the world is actually low input agriculture. They cannot afford fertilizers and irrigation, so the crops have to deal with low soil fertility and drought. Drought, of course, is even a problem in countries like the U.S. But we're trying to understand how we can get plants to adapt to these conditions and grow better despite these stresses.
How can you grow crops without nutrients and water?
Your grandmother would probably tell you that if you want a plant that was going to do well under drought conditions or poor soils, you need a good root system. Certainly any farmer will tell you that, you need a good root system. And scientists have known this for many years. Roots are important for getting water and nutrients out of the soil. But what exactly is it about roots that is most important for that? What's the difference between a good root system and a bad root system? How do we select plants that have better root systems? One of the main components of a good root system is having a good architecture, meaning the shape of the root system, how it's arranged, where it is in the soil. The main backbone roots of a root system, or the main structural, architectural scaffolding of a root system from which lateral roots emerge and all the finer roots emerge, those are called axial roots. And they can be sort of shallow, going out in the topsoil from a plant, or they can be deep. Surprisingly, this is the kind of thing that, you know, in retrospect is obvious, but it hadn't been done before. We found genetic variation for that, those angles, those growth angles. So plants that had shallow roots were much better at taking up phosphorus, which is in the topsoil. Plants that have deep roots were much better at taking up water. Well, there's a trade-off here. You can get good phosphorus acquisition by having shallow roots, but at the cost of reduced water acquisition, reduced drought tolerance. And we had a student show that in the field in Honduras, that if you had shallow-rooted plants, you'll have a significant growth advantage under low phosphorus, but you're going to become more drought sensitive. If you have deep-rooted plants, you'll have significantly improved drought tolerance, but now you're not taking up the phosphorus. See, now that's a problem, because in Honduras or in developing countries, they have both drought and low soil fertility.
Are there some plants that could combine both systems, root systems nearer to the surface and root systems that go deep?
We think we have discovered a trait that would help us get shallow and deep. And we're working on a couple more traits, ways we can combine topsoil foraging or topsoil exploration with subsoil exploration. But this is exactly why research is needed. Nobody knows the answer to your question. Nobody knows, can we really get a plant that can do both shallow and deep well without reducing yield? We have ideas, we have hypotheses, but they have to be verified with actual plants in the field before breeders are going to believe them. We think we have some solutions. By trying to get plants, develop plants that put roots where the goodies are, where the phosphorus is, where the nitrogen is, where the water is, that's how we're going to improve crop production in these stressful environments. But in these poor countries, people may not be literate, they may not have access to government services, they may not have much money or, you know, capability to do some sort of new farming system, or, you know, they don't have machinery. One thing they can do is plant a new seed. They're planting seeds now. If you give them a better seed, suddenly they might get significantly more food and more yield. So that's an important improvement there. In the U.S., if we had corn plants that needed less fertilizer, then we can reduce the cost of growing corn for American farmers, and we could reduce the environmental impact.
How far off is the end result?
We have already had impact with our work. There are bean varieties being grown today in Africa, Asia, and Latin America that have better root traits because of our work, that have better yield in low fertility soils and drought prone soils. That's happening today. We can double or triple yields without fertilizer just by selecting for these better root traits. When we look at maize lines that have these good root traits for nitrogen and water acquisition, we're talking about maybe a 3 to 4-fold increase in yield under drought in a recent study. In a study we published last year, we had an 8-fold increase in yield under drought. That's 8 times more yield without water. So we're, instead of putting on more fertilizers, putting on more water, we're just selecting for a better seed. And by having a better root system, then we can have a much better crop. So we're already achieving impact, and I think the impact is going to continue. The overall picture is that we're at a moment in human history where we're really coming up against biological limits of what we can do. We can't just assume that we'll be able to continue making more fertilizer, putting on more irrigation systems. There aren't enough resources to go around. We can make progress on this problem. We can improve yields, but we can do that. It's not going to take some kind of, you know, magic technology that hasn't been invented yet. We can do this using conventional plant breeding, just using common sense.